Hello everybody. Well, today I'm going to show you a pattern for a region. This isn't a design, this is a pattern. It's just a drawing, made up bit of land that I dreamt up as conveniently as possible for the designer, that's me. And I just want to show you the basis of that and all the thought that's gone into it to apply it to the region in which I live. And then how you apply that to a given piece of land, and that's what I'm about to do. There's a piece of land next door that's become available for sale, and it's quite an interesting exercise, so I'm just going to run through that. Now, I live in the Limousin region of France, which is pretty much smack bang in the middle of France. It's just before we get to the first mountains, so we're not in a continental climate. We're in a climate where it's not very regular. The only thing that I've observed since 2005 is that April's nearly pretty much guaranteed that you get 3 weeks of sunshine. And apart from that, you might get a wet, grey summer. You might get a very blue sky, cold, nose-biting winter. And you might get both. You might get completely the opposite. The last 2 years, however, we have seen a very marked difference in that we get a distinct wet season and a distinct dry season. Last year took everyone by surprise. It rained from December until June. We hardly saw any blue sky, whereas normally we do get a nice cold blue sky bit during the middle of the winter at some point. And then in June, it suddenly turned very hot, very dry, too hot for the vegetables. too hot for things to grow nicely, and of course May and June had been so grey and no sunlight that anything that we were trying to grow had a very hard time getting started. So we've all gone a bit back to the drawing board to work out what we can do about that and how we can temporise, especially the water. We're mostly, there are a few clay pockets here and there, but we're mostly on a sandy soil which is on a granite bedrock. It's not quite nice deep soil in most places, until you start getting up to about 800 meters, where it suddenly gets quite thin and mossy. The soil is sort of a mix. There's a bit of clay in it, but it's mostly quite free draining. The swales I've been digging have only been a spade's width wide and a spade deep, and I can run all the water from a nice big tin hanger into just a 5 meter swale, and the swale hardly ever fills up. You need really torrential rain to get the swales to fill up, and you do need to put your swales on a 4-degree slope, a 4% slope, instead of having them completely level, because they're not for catching runoff unless you're on really steep slopes. They're just for guiding excess water from the hardware, from the roofs and from the roads out across the land, just to try and get that water down into the water table to keep the wells filled up, because then we need to pump the wells like mad in the summer to be able to keep up with the watering, because obviously the soil's quite free draining and it does dry out quite quickly. You know, raised beds, well mulched, well worked through, that have had lots of love and care, they'll hold out for about 15 days of really hot dry weather before you have to start watering, and you're actually better off starting watering after about 10 days, because otherwise the soil dries out and you need to catch up on the hydrology. So it's a region that produces mostly veal calves, and they're not veal calves that are produced locally, they're just born locally, and then most of them are shipped out by lorry down to Italy to be fattened up on maize silage in cages, and then they come back here live to be slaughtered here, which allows them to qualify for a locally grown produce label. It's all upside down. The farmers, to be able to produce these veal calves, they do lots and lots of driving around in tractors in ever decreasing circles in their fields. They used to produce hay, now they produce maize silage a little bit. They produce a bit of grain, and you know, short varieties of grain, because they don't want too much straw, even though they need the straw for bedding. And they grow, they cut the grass now before it arrives at maturity to make haylage or silage, which then obviously requires all that single-use plastic to wrap the bales up to freeze the fermentation process. It is getting worse. And one of my objectives as a permaculture pilot in the region, I'm not the only one, there's not very many of us, is to produce a model, an agricultural model that stands up economically. because that is the vector that will make people change over to more intelligent practices. So we're going to be looking at small-scale agriculture with as much stuff piled into the design as we can possibly get, but it's not going to be too strange. You're not going to be planting mango trees in greenhouses next to heat-absorbing walls and stuff like that. Going to keep it nice and local, so that's chestnut, apple, hazelnut. Peaches grow incredibly well, even though it wouldn't seem hot enough for peaches. I will be planting a couple of rows of apricot trees as well, as the weather keeps getting hotter, and a few grapevines thrown in there as well, just to see as time goes on. Obviously strategically placed in places where they'll be sheltered and where they can profit from that extra heat, next to a stone wall or next to a south-facing dam or something like that. Okay, so on with the pattern, we've got, I'll just move the camera around a bit so you can see the whole, two hills on this, in this nice fictive Hobbiton picture, and a dip in the middle, and the contour lines obviously swinging out here, dipping in the middle of the valley, and then swinging out again on the outside. Okay. Because it is a livestock orientated area, and that's not for no good reason, it's because growing vegetables is bloody hard work. You need greenhouses, preferably against stone walls. Most of the houses, for some reason that I've still not been able to work out, were planted orientated north-south in long, they're long north-south buildings, so they've got hardly any south-facing walls. You've just got the gable end of the whole building which can see the sun. So you're pretty much better off, if you've got the time and the money, of taking the houses down and recuperating the stone and putting them back up again. When you do start pulling the stone walls apart, some of them are like 90 centimeters thick. I'm a stonemason and a carpenter on the side, and it's absolutely scandalous the amount of stone. You wonder how people ever managed to do it. Obviously people had a lot more energy than we do today, probably to do with the food. So that aside, coming on to the pattern, following both Alan Savory's work, Joel Salatin's work, a little bit of Jeff Lawton's work, and some personal observations from when the neighbours' cows kept getting out onto our spare bit of land, or what was our spare bit of land. We've now started drawing some designs out on it and started planting some stuff. But 2 years ago, the neighbours' cows kept getting through his pretty badly put up fences, and they would come and eat all our long grass because they hadn't got any left their side of the fence. And so I sort of just blocked the exits. They couldn't get out onto the road and let them graze for a day, kept the grass down for me. And then I'd go and knock on his door and say, look, your cows are on our land, come push them back. So we'd push them back together, and he'd come and bodge the fences up again. And then when the grass grew back, well, the cows got out again. So I managed to see that kind of cell grazing action of the cows pulling on the grass and yanking on the root net, and the change that it made in the soil. And it's actually quite astounding. When you walk out there after two passages of the cows coming on and just pulling on that grass for a day, and grazing it all off, first of all the grass grew back exceptionally quickly, and secondly you felt like you're walking on the moon. The ground became like a sponge. You could definitely imagine that ploughing it up would be really easy. And the whole weed system, or the indicator plant system, changed completely. On the other side, where he's rolling his tractor around five times a year, that's running around with the mower to cut the hay, and then running around with the fluffer to turn it and row it up, and then bale it, and then obviously pick up the bales. And then he knows that he's made the soil go acid because the agricultural engineer from the Ministry of Agriculture has told him so, and so he has to put some lime on the field. So that means running around the field again, which is counterproductive. And then of course in the spring the field just goes yellow with dandelions, and so he runs around with a topper again, to be able to top the dandelions off, thinking that if he tops the flowers they won't go to seed, and the reduce in the seed production will reduce the dandelion population. It's quite the inverse, because dandelions quite intelligent, and they manage to flower up just below the topper blade level in case he comes back round, and then seed out anyway. Our side of the fence, where his cows had come in and eaten the grass for a day, and then a couple of months later for a day, were hardly any dandelions, and sorrel, clover, all sorts of different types of grasses getting in there, and I'm quite sad about it actually, because I've only been running chickens around because I haven't got enough land to run cows round on, and I've been running chickens and ducks, and it's been getting quite hard to keep that nice meadowy texture to it. There's sort of these kind of pampasy couch grasses sticking their heads up and making clumps all over the place, which nobody seems to want to eat. We're going to expand. We're going to buy some land, which I'll show you about later on in the following videos. And what we're going to do is run cows around as pilots. So we're going to divide the land up into lots of small parcels. Now, this pattern was based on my ideal bit of land as a 5-hectare bit of land. So that's about 8 acres. And the idea, obviously, to find the key point and have one lot of fields above the key point and then forest, okay? Unless there's some nice flat land in the valley at the top. Keep the hilly bit in forest because obviously it's a nice dynamic accumulator uphill of the runoff, and obviously to put a lake in the dip in the middle, and then divide the rest up into about 42, nice magic number for any Douglas Adams fans, 42 small fields. So that's 42 small fields, working in metric because I'm in France, 800 square meters each. So that's 32 meters on one side, 25 on the other, give or take. It's not dogmatic. It doesn't have to be that size. If the contour line swings out or swings in, it could be a bit smaller. It could be a bit bigger. We're not going to cut our nose off to spite our face. So to divide it up, obviously start off with the contour lines, and we'll make what I call the horizontal tracks. So that's this one. This one, and the one the other side of the lake up there. And to be able to get to these tracks, there's the up and the down, which are over here. And those are lined up with the peak. Okay, so we can see this one. It's lined up with the peak. It's where the contour line swings out at its furthest. And this one as well, where the contour line swings out the furthest, to make the up and down tracks. Because 800 square meters for 5 big animals isn't a lot of space. It's enough food, but it's not enough space for that running around. When they start bucking and biting each other and chasing each other around and having fun, I want them to be able to have some sort of sense of freedom to keep it as natural as possible. So you can see the gate is actually open. They're not closed into that field. They can get out anytime they like. And all this space, those 4 horizontal tracks, and the up and the downers, and even the dead end tracks at the sides, okay, if we can imagine that the cut-off point with the neighbour would be here, there's some dead end tracks as well, the same on contour, and they can run into those dead end areas as well, and those dead end areas make up nice little bits where we could probably, like, if we needed to treat the sheep or to shear them or to pen them in for a couple of hours while we do something else, they could be penned in there in those tracks with just a gate across the track. So the big herbivores, they can run round wherever they like, and of course they can get to water because they drink a lot of water in a day, and I don't want to be bringing water into the fields, and I don't really want to be running kilometres of pipe and burying it. We need to bury pipe at 60 centimetres down to stop it freezing here in the winter. I don't want to be digging all that up and burying pipes and then having problems with it later, and I don't want to be buying 42 water troughs either. Okay, so that's the beginning of the procedure. The cows can come in and they can pull on the long grass, pull on the root net, get that soil aired, get lots of air pockets in there, and obviously they're going to poo. So there's, when they come out, the horse is in there as well, just because the horse is a big herbivore and it can also have the freedom to run around and drink. Although I will be ideally. I would be putting that horse into work for a couple of hours every other day, or maybe even every day. So when the cows have finished after 3 days of grazing in that parcel, close the gate and open another one. So there we've got some nice long grass that's had 90 days rest, because we can go round in the 42. There's a few spare fields in that 42, but we're working 3 days. By 3 day period, we're looking on a 90 day cycle for the animals to come round with some breathing space in case it's cold and the grass doesn't grow, for example. On to the next video in a couple of minutes.